Hello again, everybody, and welcome to another edition of Playoff Memories. And what great memories we have. The 1992 Stanley Cup Final between the Pittsburgh Penguins and the Chicago Blackhawks. The Penguins would win the series in four straight and win 11 straight games on the way to their second cup in consecutive years. And with us today are two guys who played for the Penguins in 92 and one guy who was playing for the Chicago Blackhawks. And yes, that guy also is a former Penguin. So it's Kevin Stevens, Phil Bourque, and none other than Rob Brown, who was certainly a big part of the Penguins picture in the late 80s, playing on that line with Mario Lemieux. But in this game, he wasn't wearing 44. In this series, he was wearing number 22 for the Chicago Blackhawks. What a pleasure it is to have Kevin Stevens, Phil Bourque, and Rob Brown to look back at the 1992 Stanley Cup Final.
Yeah, this is awesome, man.
Good to be here, Staggy.
Let's get right to game one. The Hawks rolled into Pittsburgh. I'm sorry, Brownie.
I thought you were bringing me on to talk about my greatest memories. I didn't know this was about the series that I lost. This is no fun.
We'll get into that a little bit too at some point. But let's start with game one of this final. And as we set it up, the Hawks rolled into town having won 11 straight games. The Penguins had won 7 in a row in the playoffs. And what I remember, Brownie, is the night before game one, it was a Monday night, the Hawks came to the William Penn Hotel in a big meeting room, and that's where the media got a chance to meet with the players. And I still can see you guys filing into this room, and I'm thinking, man, these guys are big. There was Peluso and Grimson and Steve Smith and Jocelyn Lemieux, and Mike Hudson was a pretty tall player. And I just remember thinking, man, these guys are on a roll. They must be feeling pretty invincible right now. I just want to ask you to give the Penguins fans a perspective on what the feeling was on your team as you came into Pittsburgh having won 11 straight.
We were confident, but I think we also, it's me especially, since I played with a number of the guys on the Penguins, I knew how good they were. I knew that we'd won 11 straight, and it was funny. I still remember this. I remember thinking before we went into the series, we've won 11 straight. That's a record. But if the Penguins were to sweep us, they would have won 11 straight too. And I'm like, that was in the back of my mind the whole time. we were confident, but I don't think there was any overconfidence. They were the defending Stanley Cup champions. They had the best player in the world on their team. They had the best number two center in the world on the team in Ronnie Francis. I think there was no one that was really expecting the Chicago Blackhawks to be in the finals. Our playoffs didn't start well. We felt blessed to be there. There was a quiet confidence, but we also knew that the road ahead of us was much harder than any road we had to go through so far.
And Bourque, the Penguins had won 7 in a row, and you're at home for the Stanley Cup Final, and it's a different kind of dynamic. The Hawks are a big, heavy, forechecking team. What were your thoughts as you went into that series, knowing the style, the contrast in styles between the two clubs?
A couple thoughts going in that I knew the Penguin history in Chicago, that we had not played well over the years. But in the back of my mind also was the last time we were in that building. If you remember, Staggy, that was the game where Rick Tocchet broke his jaw, came out with the football mask and led us back to victory. Larry Murphy with a big goal in that game. So that was kind of in the back of my mind. But, yeah, we knew they were rough and tumble. We knew they were going to try to probably take this series into the alley. They had some physical players, some big players, and they were coached by Mike Keenan. We all knew the way that Mike Keenan likes to coach his teams.
So, Kevin, you're a big guy and a guy who can certainly match up with that style of hockey. I imagine you were relishing the opportunity to play in a series that was going to be a physical series.
Yeah, I think so. I think all of us, you know, when you get to that point in time where there's only two teams left, I think we're both pretty confident teams. You know, we're not going in there with a lot of confidence. We're not going to win anything. So I think, you know, with our size and our guys, and like, you know, Brownie said, when you get the players we had, you know, I was pretty confident that we could go in there and, you know, like we said, it was a four game series. We won it in four, but if you look at all those games, it wasn't a four game sweep. You know, they could have won any one of those. They could have won four in a row against us. You know, the games were that tight, and that, you know, the way that they came out, like the first two, the first game especially, you know, all this was a hard fought series. It wasn't really a four game sweep if you look at it. Yeah, we did it, but man, we could have lost any one of those games, you know.
I understand, and what I thought was interesting, Artie, was right from the start of that game, you saw the contrast. You saw the Penguins having to kind of adjust to the physicality. They were pinching their D. They were laying thundering checks on people, and you guys sort of had to adjust to that at the beginning. Do you remember that? That they kind of established that style against you right away. It was pretty clear what they were trying to do.
Yeah, they came out. You know, the first game they came out and pretty much controlled a couple periods. Really, you know, it's they took control of the first game, and we were kind of stuck a little bit. Like you said, they controlled the pace, they controlled the physicality, they controlled where we could move in the neutral zone, and you know, wasn't a lot going on until we had that little comeback. But it was a dogfight. You know, it was like a bounce here, a bounce there. That's what these games are, and they really established themselves. They're a good, you know. To get that far, nothing's easy, right? You know, they're winners. They know what's going on.
Brownie, you were involved in, with that Hawk mentality. What do you remember Mike Keenan saying to the boys in Chicago prior to this game and the way that they wanted you guys to target the Penguins skill players? Because they certainly were doing a lot of that, too. I thought there were a lot of high sticks, a lot of high hits, and pretty intimidating stuff at the beginning.
Well, that's the way that Mike Keenan coached. He dragged you out of your comfort zone and made you play the style that he wanted. We talked before the game that the skill level of the Penguins, and we had to make sure that we finished every check. We were physical. We were in their face during scrums, get in their face during scrums, try to take, as Artie said, try to take it into an alley. You're not going to win a track meet against a team that has the Marios, the Yarmirs, the Ronnie Francis, players like that. You're not going to beat them in by skill. We didn't have the skill to do it. So we had to play our own style of hockey. I mean, Mike Keenan was the guy that in Chicago, there's an organ loft. And in the organ loft during pregame skates, he would sit up there. If you ever watched the Blackhawks at that time in their pregame skate, like they're going bar down on every shot. They're going full speed every time because you knew that if you had a bad warm-up, Mike Keenan wasn't playing you, and you took that mentality into the games.
Wow, that's amazing.
So the Hawks watched our warm-ups. They watched our warm-ups. We wouldn't have a team.
So the Hawks get a couple of goals. They get a power play goal from Chelios. Michel Goulet scores. Then Dirk Graham, their captain, scores to make it 3-0. And the Penguins get a power play opportunity. Kravchuk holds Mario Lemieux. Scotty calls a timeout at that point because the big boys had been on the ice when the penalty was drawn. So he wanted to give them time to get their win, to get the power play on the ice. But the top power play unit doesn't get the job done. And who scores, but none other than the old two-niner, Phil Bourque, on a wraparound. Bourque, tell us about that goal and how it all unfolded.
And I was lucky enough to find a loose puck in behind the goal, a wraparound on Eddie Belfour, found the five hole. And, yeah, that got the crowd into it. And you know our teams back then, Artie, Brownie, that three goals down wasn't insurmountable, especially when it was still in the first period. So to get us back 3-1, that hope was there because the fans were into it.
And I think I agree with Bonnie. If they go up 4-0, we lose the game. You know, so that Borky's goal to make it 3-1. You know, we all know that decides when you that third. Yeah, you know, with our team, 4 would be tough. But through three, making it 3-1, that was a huge, huge goal for our team.
Well, and then look at it from our side of it too. Is we're sitting on the bench, and if power play comes out, we're thinking ahead. We have a three goal lead. Their best units coming out with their great players. And if we stop them, and now we got a little bit of confidence, and then the second unit comes out and scores, that is a backbreaker. As you say, 4 goals is a big difference, especially back at that era. 4 goals nowadays, it's much different. But when your second power play unit comes out and scores a goal, and all of a sudden now it's just a 2-goal lead, that was a huge difference.
You know, Bourque, I was going into that series, I was looking at Belfour, and I was thinking, this guy always puts his paddle down on the ice. And it was no other goalie did that. He would lay that paddle down all the time. Guys would started to do it when there were wraparounds, and maybe that was the only time. But he did it a lot. You stepped out on that. That wasn't the classic wraparound where you came around trying to stuff it in. Could you talk about what your strategy was there? Because he put the paddle down, and he was – I thought that he lunged a lot when he did that. That's kind of what he did there.
You know what? I got a great story because I have to give Bob Erie a lot of credit for me scoring this goal. We were sitting on the bench next to each other early in the game, and we're talking about wraparounds. And Bobby had said to me, he says, you know, if you get a wraparound, take an extra step out on Belfour because he's a little off balance. So normally on a wraparound, you try to stuff it between the skate and the post. But on that play, I listened to Bobby in my head saying, take an extra step out from behind the goal line, let Belfour come out a little bit, fall forward a bit, and then catch him on the five hole. That's exactly what happened.
Amazing. That's a really amazing story. And so it was 3-1, and Brownie took a holding penalty.
Terrible call. Absolutely horrible call.
Move your feet, Brownie.
I couldn't catch him. He was too fast and too big. I do remember exactly what I did. I don't remember much of my career, but I do remember on that one, I turned the puck over, and I was not letting him get away, so I held on for dear life.
Porky, I noticed right after one period, 3-1, this early second period, you're decked twice at center ice. I mean, there were guys getting flattened. I mean, just run over in this series. Did you feel that? Like, there's a point later in this show that I want to talk about a time when you really got shaken up in the neutral zone. But just on one shift, you know, you're getting knocked down, and this and Penguins are knocking Hawks down. But it isn't just, you know, good body contact. We're talking about thundering hits where guys are getting run over and stuff. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I remember being mad at myself because that, in our scouting report, we were told, hey, keep your head up through the middle of the ice. They got some big guys on the blue line that like to step up in those open ice hits, and it was my own fault to get laid out.
So there's a make sure I got going right here. So then they scored to make it 4-1. Brent Sutter scores. Okay. So 13:21 of the second period, there's a too many men on the ice call. And Rick Tocchet tips in a Paul Stanton shot to make it 4-2 on a just after the power play had expired. So it was 3 seconds after the power play had expired. And Paul Stanton and Sean McEachern, a couple of Boston boys, assist on the goal. And then Mario scores. And that's the one where he banks it off Eddie Belfour. Artie, you ran interference. I wonder if you remember this. You had you took three Hawks with you, I think. And Mario went down below the goal line. Do you remember that?
Yeah, I remember the goal. I don't really remember what I was involved in that goal. I remember just getting to the net, and I know. You know, Mario with the puck, you never know what he's going to do with it. So it's kind of like, you know, he's the only guy in the world can think fast enough to bank pucks off people. You know, like, you know, most of us can't think that quick. You know, I'm not thinking about, I couldn't do it. I watch people do it, especially him. I'm like, how do you think that fast? And Joe, even if he was to shoot at a coach, he's, how do you think that quick? They're aiming at the coach and gunning at him. Like, you know, he's pretty good. He's pretty good at all that stuff. You know, we were, it's amazing how quick he can think, and you know, offensively, his mind is ahead of most of us, you know, the next step. But he's, you know, those are big goals. When Tocchet tipped that one in, you know, to make it 4-2 again, they make it 5-1, you know, we're done. You know, so we get another one. We had another one to make it 4-2, and then Mario gets one. Then it's, you know, it's a whole new game, you know.
Mario banks it in, and Bourque, what stands out in my mind about the bank shot is when I look at it on the replay, Mario's below the goal line. So Eddie Belfour's cheating. He thinks Mario's going to pass the puck in front of the net. That's really the key there, I would say, is that Mario was able to bank it in, but if Belfour just hugs the post, he doesn't have any place to bank it into. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, exactly right. And anybody else does that, it's probably a mistake. But you knew that Mario, just that little hesitation that he has and the zip that he puts on it, because it's got to shoot it hard. Because otherwise, he just hits his pad and falls down. But he rips it into his pad, perfectly banked off his pad and in the goal. I think when that one went in, I think our whole bench believed we were going to win that game.
I think the goalie really.
You having played with Mario, you played on a line with Mario in 88-89 when he had 199 points. And you scored a ton of goals, and you were one of the great wingers that he ever played with. You had seen him do a lot of crazy stuff. But what were your thoughts when you saw that? It was kind of like deja vu, I imagine.
Well, as already said, most players can't think quick enough to do that. It's one of those where you get back to the bench. You know what? Maybe I should have banked it off the goaltender, but you don't think in the moment to do it. To me, nothing surprised me that Mario could do. I mean, I was fortunate to play with him, but just watching the stuff he did in practice. Like, there's stuff that he never even brought out of his, you know, his toolbox because he didn't need to when he got to the games. But you knew he had the ability. And anytime there was a fear, anytime the puck was on his stick, there was a fear that something bad was going to happen to our team. And that was just one of those moments.
It was an amazing time and everybody went crazy. You made it 4-3. Artie, just so you know, if you look at the replay again, you did run interference there. There were a bunch of Hawks being just kind of plowed into by you and allowed Mario to kind of go around behind you and then down below the goal line. And he banked it in. So it's 4-3 after two. We go to the third period. Paul Stanton hooks Michel Goulet. And what I was thinking of just as I was thinking about this part, I was thinking, where's Jeremy Roenick? Like, he was so quiet in this game. Now, Barrasso did make a glove save on him during this power play that I don't even think the shot was on the net, but they probably credited him with a shot on goal. But he had had no shots. So I just want to know, Bourque, what and Artie, what your strategy was, how much Jeremy Roenick was a guy that you guys respected and feared, and what you thought of the fact that at that point he hadn't done much.
I knew Jeremy. Jeremy was, you know, phenomenal player. You know, obviously at any time he was going to you let him loose a little bit, he's going to score a goal on you. So we kind of contained him in that first game. I got a good story. I remember JR, and at game three when we went to Chicago, I saw him on the beach, we were walking and he was out and I was out, and I talked to him for like 10 minutes and Keenan walked by, right? And JR was literally thought he wasn't going to play game three because he was talking to me like when Keenan walked by. That's a story that I'll remember as long as I live, because, you know, I knew JR from Boston, you know, and it was like one of those things that him talking to our team is like, it's a no-no with Keenan, you know? So it was one of those, and JR was, you know, he's a 50 goal scorer. He scores at any time. He was, you know, he was in his prime. He was flying around. But, you know, it's a tight game. Those games, you know, there's not a lot of chances all the time for guys, you know, and he was the key guy for our team to stop. So we were, you know, we had guys like Bourque and we had Bobby. We had guys that could kind of skate a little bit with big for our team up front, you know.
Another thing I want to bring up is Tom Barrasso here, because now it's 4-3. Hudson gets a great chance. He goes flying. He had some great speed. He goes down the left side on his off wing, cuts in, and Barrasso makes a big save on him. Tommy had this knack, and this game was a perfect example of it, of not letting the team, the opposition, score that next goal, the one that would put you guys in a precarious position. So you make it 4-3, but if he doesn't make that save on Hudson, it's back to 5-3, and a lot of the air comes out of the balloon. You know what I mean? That was kind of his thing.
Tommy did it all the time, right? Had already been touched before, but he knew the situation, knew that we battled back and we're back in the game, and he embraced those moments. He didn't really care about his stats. He cared about the Ws. He had that feeling of, okay, I can't let another one in here, and he stepped up and made some big saves.
Yeah, the best thing about Tommy, I think, is, you know, if he lets a goal in, he don't think about it. You know, he can focus right again, and he's right there for you again. Like, and even if he lets a bat, whatever his position is, Tommy's one of those guys that can brush those things off pretty well, and he's there right for us again. Like, and he, like I said, if anything happens, you know, it's 5-3, and, you know, it's a different ballgame. The goalies are huge, you know, and especially when you're trying to get back.
Brownie, it's 4-3. It's not like you're behind in the game. You're still up, and you're getting some chances, right? But Tommy's coming up large here to keep the Penguins within striking distance.
Well, at that point, we knew we had to score the next goal. It was – momentum was on the Penguins' side. They're coming back. We know that a one-goal lead against the Pittsburgh Penguins is more or less a tie game when they've got Mario on the other side. So we knew we had to score next, and the chances didn't go in for us. And at that point, I don't know if it was fear, but you're looking at the clock, hoping the clock goes a little faster, and you're hoping that you can somehow run the timeout on the Penguins, because it's just one bad break or one bad bounce for us away from this being a tied game. And you didn't want it. We couldn't afford to get this to be a tied game, because that would have been too big a hill to overcome, because the entire momentum would have been on Pittsburgh's side. So we knew that the importance of the next goal, and unfortunately for us, we never got it.
And Brownie, you said you're new in the, when Mario was on the other side, the one goal lead, but it turned out to be Jaromir Jagr who made Mario later called the greatest goal he'd ever seen.
Well, and it's one of those things too. A goal against was bad. Obviously it tied up the game. But that goal, the way it was scored against the players it was scored against, I'm pretty sure it was Brent Sutter was out there. Chris Chelios was out there. Like, these were our best players, our best defensive players. And for Jaromir to score that goal, I mean, the place didn't stop buzzing. And it was A, because they tied the game, but B, because of the way they tied the game. And now all of a sudden, it was almost like we felt we were behind simply because they've come all the way back to tie us and they scored one of the prettiest goals you're going to see scored against you. So, yeah, at that point, we were like, uh-oh, this isn't good.
Okay, so guess what? You guys end up with a power play. And Brownie, you're on the second power play unit. Penguins kill the opportunity. This was a great chance for the Hawks to reestablish control of the hockey game. You don't really get power plays that late in a hockey game to begin with. So here you were with a chance to retake the lead.
Well, again, the importance of a moment. And I mean, I don't recall the exact moments on that power play, but I am sure that the Penguins on their bench are saying the same thing. We kill this, we win a hockey game. And they got to get a couple big saves. And everything just, again, everything is just going right now the Penguins' way. So it's one of those ones, if we have a 4-3 lead going on that power play, we're pretty sure we're going to score that fifth goal and put the game out of reach. But now the pressure's on us. If we don't score on that power play, all of a sudden Pittsburgh, it's like, okay, they killed the penalty, here they come. So the pressure was on us to score a goal. We didn't do it. And sure enough, that was our chance to win a game. And honestly, could have changed the way the series went. You win the first game. We have more confidence in our dressing room, but we don't score. We don't win. And we obviously see how the series went.
Yes, yeah, so because right after that, Bourque, Mario draws the penalty. Steve Smith hooks him a bit. I think he goes a kind of.
Oh, it was a terrible dive. Horrible call.
We've all gone for a little swanny dive in our careers. Come on.
What'd you think, Artie, when you saw Mario draw the penalty there?
Yeah, you know, it's you know, momentum. We had all the momentum in the world, kind of like, you know, he can draw penalty. No one can draw penalty like he can draw them. You know, Bourque could draw them pretty well, too. but no one draws a penalty like Mario draws a penalty. But you know what? No one gets held and grabbed like Mario got held and grabbed for 10 years. So, you know, it's not, you know, they owe him a lot of them. But yeah, that was a difficult, you know, we got a break on that call, but. Now we can maybe jump ahead. Now we can try to, you know, see what we can do in the building buzzing, as Brownie said. You know, when Jagr gets a goal, he pulls it off the boards like that. It's only craziness in Pittsburgh. So hopefully we can build on that.
Well, only 17 seconds to go. So if you don't score on the power play here, it's going to the power play is going to extend into overtime. It never gets to that because Ronnie wins a faceoff. And Bourque, maybe you can take it from there. Ronnie wins the draw back to Larry Murphy, and the rest is history.
Yeah, Ronnie, I think, used his feet, as he was so good at on a face-off, to kind of kick it back to Larry Murphy. And I think one of the more underappreciated plays in this goal is the play by Murph to not only keep that puck in and keep it and get it towards the goal where Belfour can't control the rebound and eventually goes to Mario, because Steve Larmer was coming out to Murph. If Larmer chips that puck past Murph, as you mentioned, you're probably like at 15 seconds at that time. Larmer's got a clear-cut breakaway in a tie game and maybe scores a shorthanded goal to win it for the Hawks. But Murph keeps it in, puts it off the pads of Belfour, and then Mario with those incredibly strong hands gets that rolling puck to just get up over a sprawled out Eddie Belfour. And what's maybe the loudest I've ever heard, the Civic Arena, it was the building was literally shaking after that.
But it's only one loss, Brownie. It's 5-4 win for the Penguins. Incredibly dramatic, phenomenal. But, you know, you get a day off between games and you're going into game two. What are the Hawks thinking at that point?
Well, heartbroken to start with. I mean, you have a 4-1 lead in the Stanley Cup Finals game one. I mean, that's a game you should win. And then all of a sudden, there's a lot more pressure on you in game two. You don't want to fall down 2-0. I know you're going home after that, but... I mean, just go through the history of stats. Down 2-0 in a series doesn't usually work out well for your team. So
you pulled your groin in game one, Brownie?
I did. I tried taking a long stride, and I wasn't a very good skater. I know you guys can't believe that, but so I tried going a little bit quicker, pulled my groin, and horrible. I mean, having to miss a game in the Stanley Cup Finals. So yeah, so I watched from the stands game two, and was. Even more frustrating because, as you know, when you're on the bench, you feel you can make a difference. But when you're sitting in the bench or in the stands, it's really hard watching a hockey game when things don't go the way for your team.
So we get to game two. The shots are 8-4 Hawks with 7 minutes to go in the first. So it's a different kind of game. I saw an interview with Barry Smith between periods. He says, it's like two heavyweight teams kind of feeling each other out. It did kind of settle into that in game two. Game one was wild. Game two felt more like a playoff game where the two teams were being a little bit more careful, especially in the first period. First goal of the game, a shorthanded goal by Bob Airey. Amazing. He had done that in game two of the Minnesota series the year before. Bourque, you had scored the first goal in game one. It's amazing how you role players really came up big for the Penguins and scored huge goals, ones that maybe people don't think about. But that first goal shorthanded in that game was really big. And Bobby was able to get some speed, get a step, and find a way to backhand one in on Eddie Belfour.
Like Brownie said, the seed of doubt was already planted in the Hawks locker room from game number one, and then Bobby kind of drove that home. And we put them on their heels right away. That's what you need to do.
Brownie, could you talk a little bit about Mike Keenan's sort of attitude towards your team going into game two? Do you remember what kind of things he was saying and how he was managing the situation as the coach?
Well, I think there was some anger after the way that the game one finished. And the same, I mean, the way we played, as Bourque said, it was on the edge. I went to Chicago as a skilled offensive type hockey player that had to learn how to hit, how to fight, how to spear, how to cross check, how to do all those things. It wasn't part of my game, but if you wanted to play, that's the way you played. And you're put in different roles. There'd be a game that I'd be on a line playing with Jeremy Roenick and a Steve Larmer, and then the next game I'd be on the fourth line, and you had to understand what your role was. If you were playing with certain players, you played a certain way. And that's what you see with Brian Noonan, with Mike Hudson, Joss Lemieux when he was in the lineup. You played as close to the line as you possibly could.
Well, Penguins were on the power play, and Graham had a great breakaway opportunity, and he shot the puck, and it went off the shaft of Tom Barrasso's stick and up into the seats. That's how close it came to scoring and being 1-1. Okay, so I want to talk about this because this is amazing. Artie, first of all, you led the team in shots in the first period with four shots of this game, game two. Mario played 12 minutes and 40 seconds in the first period. And listen to this. He played 32 minutes in game one.
Crazy, ain't it? It's crazy. Forward, you know, playing that much. It's crazy.
Like,
you know, it's insane to think the minutes that, you know, he played, you know, times that he didn't, you know. I remember when he was hurt, Staggy, and, you know, he said he's just going to play the power play. He came out and ended up playing 30 minutes that night. You know, it's just, it's pretty crazy, you know. 32 minutes as a forward. Think about that.
That's outrageous. That only happens in overtime, like double overtime games, right, Bourque?
Yeah.
Yeah, and see, Mario played in all situations. You know, he wasn't just a skilled guy. He killed penalties. He was out there in the last minute of a one-goal game. Complete player.
So if you talk about all the great things he could do, Brownie, that was something that people don't talk about that much. It was his stamina, his ability to maintain a pretty high level, to say the least. I mean, he did score that winning goal with 17 seconds in a game, left in a game in which he played 32 minutes in game one.
Well, and you got to realize his 32 minutes are more difficult than most. As Bourque and Artie talked about earlier, he usually had one or two players hanging on to him. He would be going up the ice, and you have your stick in his chest area. You'd be grabbing his jersey. He was treated differently than a lot of superstars from the other teams because he's big and strong, and from the refs because he never went down. So he took a physical beating most nights, yet he could still put 30 minutes, 32, 35. And the problem for teams playing against him, he was just as good in minute 33 as he was in minute one. Most players aren't like that. Most players tire out. Mario's didn't seem to.
Okay, so Brian Marchment. Name becomes pretty prominent here over the next few minutes. He scores a goal to tie the game of one. Then he elbows Paul Stanton. One thing I wanted to mention, Artie and Bourque, is that there's only one referee back then. And on this night, it was Terry Gregson. In game one, it was Andy Van Helleman. It was pretty obvious to me that players became very good at trying stuff behind the back of the referee. You could get away with a lot more. That's probably why the league decided to go to two referees. But what do you remember about just the physicality of the game and the fact that guys were taking some liberties and not ones that the referee was either ignoring or not seeing at all?
No, I just remember discipline being a major factor in that series, something we talked about a lot in our pregame meetings, and that you're going to have to take a punch in the face. And, you know, we had been down this road before. You know, when we played the Minnesota North Stars in 91. They tried to get physical with us too, and we were able to take those punches and then beat them on the power play. The other part is, you know, a guy like Van Helemond, you know, you could get away with a lot more. You knew those referees on an individual basis. Gregson was a guy a little more tight to the vest. You know, he wasn't going to let you get away with so much, where Van Helemond would. So you have to know that as a player, referees game by game.
So the Penguins are 0-for-3 on the power play. And, you know, you're not really generating much. You're having a little trouble, actually, on this power play, a little bit disjointed. But the puck goes into the corner, and Artie, you go in and get a big hit on Steve Smith, the big defenseman. He goes down in the corner, and the puck comes to Tocchet. He throws it over to Mario, who rips one inside the left post on the power play, and the Penguins are up 2-1. Do you remember that, Artie? Do you remember going in there and getting that hit on Steve Smith on that play?
Yeah, I remember the play. Like, you know, I just remember trying to get in there and, you know, create a loose puck, you know, try to get in there first and get to the body. But, you know, that's, like you said, it was, you know, it was such a grudge match. And Smitty's the same type of player. Like, he's, you know, if I don't rail him, he's going to take me. So, you know, you might as well try to do what you can to get him first, because they, and like you said, Marchman too, you know, another guy, like, you know, it's a series, and it's going to be physical and it's going to be tight. And, you know, the power plays are huge. And any time in these playoffs, you know, if you can generate something on your power play and score and create offense and create that ability to get the fans involved and get our team jumping a little bit, that's huge. And, you know, anytime we could score on the power play was big.
Bourque, you got knocked down in the third period of this game. And I want to talk about that because I mentioned it earlier. Do you remember that? You were face down at center ice. Skip Thayer had to come out, and I never saw a replay. There's no replay of what happened to you, and you were down a long time.
Yeah, I don't remember that play. I don't, but there was a lot of stuff in behind the play that, again, you had to take it. Guys would butt end you, they give you a slash, or they just, you know, with the glove on, they punch you right in the face. And they, you know, if you knew where the referee was, you can get away with that stuff.
You guys win the game 3-1. And you're up 2-0 in the series, and Brownie, some weird stuff that had gone on. Okay, let's talk about some of this weird stuff from a Hawks standpoint. A lot of shots at Jeremy Roenick on the bench. Chris Chelios doesn't even play more than a couple of minutes in the second half of the third period of game two. They're not using Chelios. They're not using Roenick. Keenan's behind in the game, and they're talking about Roenick having a bad thumb. So what's going on with the Hawks here as we head back to Chicago with respect to two of their top players, guys that really can make a difference, and Keenan seems to be playing mind games?
Well, Mike always played mind games, so that was nothing new. It's funny, nowadays with media and social media and 24-hour news channels, this would be huge stories all the time, but we're playing in Chicago, so the stories weren't that big. I mean, I didn't even know the whole, because eventually Mike Keenan took Jeremy out into a press conference. I think he had a cast on, or something along that line. The players, I knew nothing about this. Everything was just normal. We were just down two and trying to figure things out. I do remember, though, going into game three, and it's just the kind of mind games and how Mike Keenan coached. In Chicago, you had to walk up the stairs to get onto the ice. Mike Keenan pulls me aside as we're going up the stairs and says, okay, tonight you're shadowing Mario. I've never shadowed anyone in my life. I couldn't even shadow my wife. Like, she's quicker than I am. And I'm about to shadow the best player in the world. I'm like, looking at him, I'm like, you know, I'm number 44. I think I was 22 at that point. Like, I'm like, hey, this isn't my role. And I did all night long. Every time Mario went on the ice, I went on the ice to shadow him. So it was just weird things. In game, that game also, middle of a game or late in the game, we're down. He, power play, he goes, all right, you're going to play defense on the power play. I'd never played defense in the National Hockey League ever. And we're in the Stanley Cup Finals in a must-win game, down a goal, and I'm playing on the point on the power play. Never practiced it with the team, never talked about it with the team. But that was just the way Mike Keenan coached. And he's had success with it, but it is weird. And as you said, mind games, different things that Mike Keenan did. Sometimes it worked, sometimes it didn't. But there were some things that happened in that series that I'm like, okay, wait a second. We're fighting for the Stanley Cup Championship, and now we're trying new things. So a little odd, but I'm never going to argue with the success he's had.
And at this point, Artie, Mario had scored that huge goal, banking it off of Belfour in game one. Big goal to win the game at game one at the end. Then he scores two goals in game two in a 3-1 win. Tocchet setting him up for both of them. In that second period, the third period, you're just hanging on, but you're playing good D. And that's the thing that stands out to me now as I'm watching the third period of game two. is that you guys, from going back to the beginning of the playoff run when you shut down the Washington Capitals, you had figured out, you really started to figure out how to play with a lead. It wasn't like the previous year when Minnesota kept coming back in games early in the series. You guys seem to know how to change your style a little bit. Is that true?
We learned, through our playoff success. You know, we, like you said, we played three series before that, all tough ones, you know, all like, you know, nailed by Washington, whoever we, you know, I forget, I think, no, Washington, Jersey, and Boston, obviously. And then, but yeah, we learned, you know, you just play a certain way when you leave, because it's only one game, right, Staggy? So you just try to figure out how to win that one game. You know, they're all different. Everyone's different. Every game's different. You don't know how, like, every game this series, if you look at it, was really different, you know. And, you know, this game was a little bit of a grudge match. There wasn't a lot of chances. There wasn't a lot of shots. There wasn't, you know, a lot up and down stuff. But, you know, when we got the lead, we were able to protect it. And I think, you know, that's a bonus to all the big guys, a lot of the guys that, you know, that play a lot of minutes, because, you know, it's hard to protect leads sometimes. But when we learned how to do it, and it worked. And when you learn how to do something, it works. You know, you stick with it.
Well, listen, guys, just to give you an idea, 39 shots in game one for the Hawks. They had only 25 in game two. But they did have some great chances, and Tom Barrasso was sensational in game two. Eddie Belfour, people are starting to question him a little bit, including his coach, who was a guy who had a knack of pulling his goaltenders. And before you go, I got to just ask you, because we're not going to focus as much on the games three and four with you guys. We're going to talk to another set of players, but you did manage to win the next two games in Chicago. And just as an overview, guys, what was it like to go into Chicago, win a game 1-0, and then win a high scoring game in game four to win the cup?
Well, for me, I want to go back to just game two real quick, and your points you made about Mike Keenan. I can remember sitting on the bench and in the locker room, we got him, boys. We got him right where we want him. Because when Roenick wasn't playing and Larmer wasn't playing and Goulet wasn't playing, their top guys, and they were going with Peluso and with Stu Grimson and Hudson and guys like that, we thought we had kind of gotten their kitchen a little bit. But we knew we weren't going to win this series by trying to win games like we did game number one. And that's when we realized we need to buckle down and play better defensively. We did that in game three. Game four was a little bit of a crazy old penguin-y hockey, but that's the way things go sometimes. You got to win those games. But we made the adjustments in-game that we need to make.
Brownie, Dominik Hasek made the scene in game four. And I know this is easy to say now, but Vladislav Tretiak was his goalie coach. He changed his number later. He was 30 with Chicago. He was 27 in Dallas because he loved Tretiak so much. I think some of his style with that paddle down was as a result of the coaching he was getting from Tretiak. But Hasek comes in. And I remember saying on the telecast, he's considered the best goalie in the world in Europe, you know. And I couldn't help but think that if maybe Keenan had turned to him and done his new normal thing of pulling his goalies, maybe the series would have been longer. I'm not saying the Penguins wouldn't have won it, but I think he may have extended that series had he gotten a chance to play. What did you guys think?
Well, I know that when I first went to Chicago and practicing against Dominik every day and day after day after day, I remember calling my buddies back home in St. Albert and said, we got a guy who's our backup goaltender that's going to be the best in the world at some point, because you couldn't score on him in practice. His work ethic was, I've never seen anyone work. He would get mad if you scored, whether it's a warm-up shot at the end of practice. He never let you score. So, I mean, I don't know if it would have changed the complexion of the series or not, but I knew practicing against Dominik Hasek that he was going to be one of the greatest goaltenders that ever played in the league, because you couldn't score, and his work ethic and his mentality was second to none. So there was a brief glimpse of Dom in the finals there, and it was a glimpse that allowed him to eventually become a Stanley Cup champion years later. So he was great. I don't know if it would have changed the complexion of the series, but we knew as a team how good he was because we practiced with him every day.
And before you go, Artie and Bourque, just quick comment on Scotty Bowman and maybe some of the things that he was doing on the bench there, just to make sure that you guys got the right players on the ice at the right time and so on.
Yeah, I think Scotty, you know, he knew how to, you know, he's probably one of the best bench coaches ever. You know, he just knew what to, you know, who to, you know, when to put him on and how much time they could play. He was a bright guy. You know, we all. Sometimes, you know, you question his what he was doing, but it always seemed to work, you know, and it always seemed to come out on the right side. And he was a big part of our win. And very smart man, very, you know, knows how to handle a bench, and, you know, had all our respect. You know, he was a guy that, you know, we played hard for, and he got the most out of all of his guys.
Bourque, tell the story about Scotty after you won the Cup in 92.
Yeah, you know, Scotty and I, we didn't have the rosiest of relationships. I've been very vocal about that. No big deal. You know, he was the coach, I was the player, and that's the way he wanted it. You know, there's no huggy-huggy like Badger Bob Johnson. That's fine. It's all in the rearview mirror. But when I did finally sign with the New York Rangers, right after winning that Cup in 92, I was in my living room in Upper St. Clair. The phone rang, and it was Scotty Bowman. And I kind of looked at the phone like, what? Like, what? I didn't even know he had my number. He just called me and said, hey, congratulations on signing with the Rangers. I just want you to know, appreciate you, everything you did, helped the Penguins win two Stanley Cups, and I kind of owe you an apology. I didn't realize you were a lot better player than I thought you were. And I kind of, you know, I saw a different side of Scotty that I'd never seen before. It was humble. It was outgoing. It was caring. And it went a long way with me on my perception of Scott Bowman.
Always a thrill to talk to former Penguins, Kevin Stevens and Phil Bourque. And also, we want to thank Rob Brown for joining us as we look back at the 1992 Stanley Cup Final, games 1 and 2. And don't go anywhere, because we're also going to take a look at games 3 and 4 as the Penguins go on to win a second straight Stanley Cup. Thanks a lot for watching, everybody, and we'll see you again for Playoff Memories. This is Paul Steigerwald.